Hello, learners. Welcome to the studio of NIOS. Myself, Dr. Ritu Bakshi, Assistant Professor, Central University of Jammu. And today, I am with you with the topic Methods, Approaches Adopted by the Social Scientists in Understanding Sociology. Dear learners, today I'll talk about what is sociology, approaches to study sociology. Various approaches will be historical, comparative, functionalist, and statistical. We will also discuss advantages and limitations of various methods and approaches which are being used to study sociology as a subject. To start with, the definition of sociology. So, what is sociology? Sociology is the study of the society. It studies the different aspects of the society and the interactions which are being going on in the society. It also studies the social norms, social sanctions, processes, structures, functions, regulations, and values of the society. What I mean to say here is, sociology overall is the study of the society and the interactions which go in the society in the form of social norms, sanctions, processes, functions, and values. There are various methods to study sociology. Social scientists use numerous methods like historical, comparative, statistical, case study methods. And dear learners, today you will learn some of the important methods and approaches used by the social scientists in understanding sociology. Methods to study sociology are, which we are going to discuss today, historical method, comparative method, functionalist method, statistical method, and the case study method. So, dear learners, today we will go one by one and we will go through these methods separately. So, coming first to the historical method. First question is, who are the founding fathers of historical method? So, Auguste Comte, Herbert Spencer, and Karl Marx. These are the founding fathers of the historical method. And historical method refers to the study of events, processes, institutions of the past societies for the purpose of finding the origins or antecedents of contemporary social life and thus understanding its nature and working. Historical methods studies the events and processes, the ways of life, the customs, the social life of people in that era, social heritage, institutions. So, dear learners, when we study sociology and when we are studying sociology preferably with historical method, we will study the events, processes, the ways of life, customs, social life, social heritage, and the various institutions. Historical sociology is based on the historical method. And it studies the society of remote, it studies the societies of the recent past. And why we study this remote and recent past history? We only study this to find the origin of our present ways and explanation for our present ways. That means what we are doing in the present days and how we are living in the present days, it is being deep rooted in the past history. So, that is the reason why we study history and why we study society through the historical method. There are various questions to ask when we go for the historical method. That is, where would I go to research this? When we are going to research the past, where should I go? So, there are 5 W's which we have to take care of. That is, who, what, where, why, and when. So, 2 forms to study the society from historical approach are very, very important. That is, and these 2 forms are influenced by biological theory of evolution, and second is through economic interpretation of the history. That is, when we study historical method, we need to go through biological theory, that is how the society is evolved. And second is, what is the economic base of that particular society. So when we study society through biological theory of evolution, this concept was first of all used by Comte and Spencer, and it concentrates on the origin and evolution of the societies. And when we talk of economic interpretation of history or economic interpretation of society, this method was first of all used by Max Weber and Karl Marx. And this method concentrates on the origin of capitalism, development of bureaucracy, and economic influence, that is power influence, and this capitalism and bureaucracy. This was the economic base to study the society. There are five steps which historians use to study the history through historical method, that is preliminary research, formulating a working hypothesis, research evidence to support or reject the hypothesis, formulate a thesis statement, and writing an historical account. So these are the five steps which historians use while they are doing research of society through historical method. There are many limitations of historical method in sociology. The historical facts as contained in the life histories, diaries, etc. may be revealing, but they have little use for scientific investigation. They may not be able to answer all the questions that may be raised by a sociologist. So this is the main limitation of this historical method. And further, the historical facts also ruin the risk of not being studied objectively by the interpreters. So the main thing is objectivity. When we talk of research, the question of objectivity in historical method comes. So this is the major limitation which we find in the historical method. The historical method therefore was not being wholly adequate and dependable for the study of social phenomenon, and it calls for the employment of other methods for inquiry into the field of sociology. So, because this method was not complete and it was subjective to much extent, so it calls for the employment of other methods also. So, now we come to other second method which is being used in the sociology, that is comparative method. The methods of comparing different societies or groups within the same society to show whether and why they are similar or different in certain respects. So we compare the two societies, we compare the two eras, we compare different people, different norms in the two eras in different functioning of the society. This method involves comparisons of various kinds of groups of people in order to find out the differences as well as similarities in their ways of life, and thus to find out the clues to man's social behavior. So this comparative method is very, very necessary to study the sociology, because through this method we can find out the differences as well as similarities in the past and in the present ways. So comparative approach studies social institutions, it studies past or existing societies. We can compare the past societies as well as existing societies. It also selects, compares, and eliminates, and it arrives at the proper generalization. So comparative method is a wholesome method. When we talk this method, when we use this method in the sociology, we can compare the two societies very well. The comparative method of studying sociology uses the existing secondary data like statistics, documents, news accounts, narratives, stories, oral histories, letters and diaries, organizational records, and artifacts. These things, these secondary data, are mostly used when we use comparative method to study sociology. Now, why comparative method? Why this method is widely used? Sociology cannot make proper use of experimental method and all its various stages of observation, classification, hypothesis, generalization, etc., with regard to a particular social phenomenon in a laboratory as the physical sciences can do. So sociology cannot do proper with experimental method, because this is very difficult when we try to study sociology. But a sociologist can surely experiment in the laboratory of the world by employing the comparative method. That's why we use comparative method over experimental method when we study sociology. This method involves comparisons of various kinds of groups of people in order to find out the differences as well as similarities in the ways of life. Thus, it finds out the clues to the man's social behavior in the present time. As we have discussed earlier, that to find the similarities and differences in various societies, this method is widely used. How India used to live in the past way, how people used to protest in the past times, and how they are doing this thing in the present. This is actually studied through the comparative approach. This comparative approach also has some limitations. It is hugely cross-sectional. It compares some variables in different societies, and same variables are being compared. Because in this method, we are not given the freedom to compare different variables. So same variables can be compared in the different societies. Comparability of data is major issue, and missing data may also be a problem when we talk of comparative approach. The application of this method is not as simple as it may appear. This is also the limitation of this method. The major difficulty in the application of this method is that the social units have different meanings in different countries. That is, cultural similarities vary in various parts of the country as well as across the countries. For example, the institution of marriage, for instance, has different meanings for people of India and for the West people. So it's very difficult if we take the same variable and if we try to compare one country with another, there is a big problem because of the cultural dissimilarities. Now, next method to study the sociology is functionalist method. Durkheim, Max Weber, and many other sociologists used this approach more frequently to study the social phenomenon. For example, Durkheim compared the suicide rates of different societies and of different groups within a society to show that these rates varied inversely with the degree of social solidarity. In functional method, functionalism has been given a greater emphasis during recent times in the sociological studies, and functionalism refers to the study of social phenomenon from the point of view of the functions that particular institutions or social structures such as class serve in the society. That is, functionalism refers or means it is comprised of two words. That is, it studies the functions which are being served in the society. Durkheim is the man who first gave the rigorous concept of social function in his book, The Division of Labor in the Society, and in The Rules of the Sociological Method. Auguste Comte and Herbert Spencer laid the foundation for studying the society from functionalist perspective. Durkheim was the champion in using this method in studying the social phenomenon. So, functionalist approach to study the society refers to the study of society or social phenomenon from the point of functions of the society, the social phenomenon, and the elements of the society. That means, if we want to study sociology from the functionalist approach, we need to go to the functions which a society does, the functions which are being done by the social phenomenon and elements of the society. According to the functionalist perspective of sociology, each aspect of society is interdependent and contributes to the society's stability and functioning as a whole. For example, the government provides education for the children of the family, which in turn pays taxes on which the state depends to keep it itself running. That is, the family is dependent upon the school to help the children grow up and to have good jobs so that they can raise and support their own families. That is, the functionalist view works on the principle of interdependence. And in this functionalist theory, if all goes well, the parts of society produce order, stability and productivity. And if all does not go well, the parts of society then must adapt to recapture a new order, stability and productivity. So, functionalism is the perspective created by, which is being created by Durkheim, and he believed that society was made up of interconnected institutions, for example, education, family, government, and which depended on each other for functioning, for smooth functioning of the society. That is, if we want to study society, if we want to study the various institutions of society, the working and interdependence of various institutions of the society, we need to go through the functionalist method to study the society. Let's make it simple. The functionalist sees the society as being similar to the human body. In the same way, the body relies on the heart to pump blood round to the vital organs like lungs and brain. That is, the functionalist, they see society like a human body. All the parts of the body are interdependent. Heart is interdependent, kidneys are interdependent. In the same way, the various institutions of the society, they work together and they serve the society together for the solidarity of the society. This approach is based on the assumption that a system is based upon the number of its constituent parts. Each part of the system is interrelated with the other parts of the system, and the function of each part of the system is understood in relation to the functions of the other parts of the system. So, system here is society, and if we compare the system with the human body, that is, the system there is human body. For example, if a society is a system, its constituent parts are religion, economy, politics, etc. And when one studies the society from functionalist perspective, he has to understand society in relation to the functions of the parts of the society like religion, economy, politics and so on. If we are studying education, if we are studying any social norm, or if we are studying family as an institution, we can study as the part of that particular system of society. Now, coming to next approach, next method which is used in the sociology, this is statistical approach. According to Bogardus, the social statistics is a mathematics applied to the human facts. Odum writes, statistics, which is the science of numbering and measuring phenomenon, objectively is an essential core of the research. James Smith writes, statistical method is a term used to describe the process of interpreting facts by the use of statistics and statistical theory. So, this approach of statistical method is used to study the social phenomenon in two ways. One is quantitative way and other is objective way. And through these two ways, we can study the economic conditions of the society, migration, crime, divorce, birth and death, and public opinion, and so many other things we can study through quantitative way as well as an objective way through the statistical approach of sociology. Professor Giddings was the first great sociologist to emphasize the importance of statistics for the social researches. It is true that most of the social data are qualitative, but still, the social scientists are trying their best to make such data quantitative and objective by the meaningful use of statistical method. The statistical method, it has an edge over other methods, because it's a fact that most of the data in sociology, it is qualitative, but we can measure this data quantitatively as well as objectively through statistical method. Much of the research work in sociology is currently being carried on with the help of the data collected through statistics. For example, in the study of population, migration, economic conditions, human ecology, this method is used. But the great difficulty in adopting the statistical method is that mostly the social problems are qualitative and not quantitative. This method can therefore be used in a limited sphere. So, this is the limitation of this method. Besides these approaches, there are many other approaches also, like case study approach, evolutionary approach, social surveys, which are in much use in studying the social phenomenon. So, dear learners, today we went through the various methods and approaches to study the sociology, and these the most important methods which we studied were the comparative approach, historical approach, functionalist approach and statistical approach. You can use other methods also, like case study approaches, evolutionary approaches, social surveys, and it will all depend on the content of the sociological study which you want to study. So, to sum up, we can say that we can use various approaches and strategies which makes the children learn and find the facts about the social sciences more effectively. And it is also felt that none of the approaches provides a comprehensive perspective on the sociology in India. Therefore, integrating the series of concepts, series of these methods relating to the sociology gave a development of a new approach or paradigm which we can call as integrated approach. So, we can use integrated approach in studying sociology, that is, we can integrate all these methods to use the study the sociological facts and figures. That is, integration of the methods is very important to study sociology broadly. So, dear learners, I hope you will be able to know about the various methods and approaches of sociology. Thank you very much.